kid. The robot. It sounds like it is.
I am.
I bet the toast is just trying to mess with our heads.
You only assumed that I was the android. It is not my fault that you held this misconception. I am as I always have been. Lord and conqueror of all I see. I am Vyce.
I've got to say, Lord Vyzine, you're looking a lot shorter than I remember.
Only thanks to the exile you imposed upon me. Tell me, champion, are you truly so naive that you think I would not have a contingency plan for such an occasion? I have battled and hunted the entity for what feels like an eternity. As I have extended my gaze, I have encountered resistance, and I've known full well what could happen to me. In the event of such a defeat, I equipped my suit with a trans-dimensional distress beacon so that my shades could come and rescue me. However, in this case, I sent the distress call and waited for 3 years. While it was possible that rescue was coming, with the time differential between universes, it was all too possible that the shades would not arrive for hundreds of years past my suit's power reserves. And even that assumed they were coming at all. Your misguided attempts at chivalry to save the universes under my control could have completely disabled all my forces. I considered my options and decided it was time to make the final sacrifice for my crusade. I have always known the nature of the entity, a creature of pure, living data. Even with my power and my weapons, it was possible that it could not be killed by conventional means. As a last resort, I knew there was one way to ensure victory. Become the very thing I hated. I am now living data, my physical form restricted to whatever object I possess.
How the hell did you get back here?
The android's hand. When you contacted me before our last confrontation, mocked and boasted to me, you closed the main communications channel, but left the signal online. The signal was always meant to be picked up by my ship behind its temporal shields. You may as well have sent a signal flare into the sky, inviting my return. I transferred back through the hand and into the nearest receptacle that could retain my new data form.
And that's why the readings resembled the entity.
I am simpler, more streamlined than the entity. However, that restricts my ability to possess, limiting myself to inhabiting a mechanical body like this one. And I unfortunately cannot transfer out. I will learn to overcome that limitation with time and study, but before then, I must take back my ship and resume my efforts to destroy the entity.
I hate to be the bearer of good news, Vyce, but your quest is over. The entity is dead.
Nonsense. You couldn't even destroy me. You hardly stand a chance against that abomination.
It's true, Vyce. I defeated it by—
Enough! I have had my fill of your treachery and insolence. Return this ship at once.
If you think you're getting this ship back, I got some bullets right here that'd be happy to cut a deal with you.
I control the propulsion system of this vessel, and with time, I can regain control of the rest.
Fine then. I'll destroy this ship before I ever let you have it again.
You wouldn't dare.
I will destroy it.
You can no more destroy this ship than you could destroy the entity.
Nimue, this is Linkara.
Recognized.
Engage auto-destruct sequence. Destruct sequence 1. Code 1. 1A. Harvey? Computer, this is Harvey Finevoice.
Recognized.
Destruct sequence 2. Code 1. 1A. 2B. Nimue?
Online. This is Nimue, onboard computer and artificial intelligence of Comicron 1, destruct sequence 3, code 1, 1B2B3.
You give the computer self-destruct control?
This unit is unable to key in the final sequence without the other codes, and there are safeguards to prevent engaging it without authorization.
And you realize that you will die as well? How does that make you feel, computer?
You are a threat to this vessel and to the freedom of all sapient beings. You will not deter this unit.
And Nimue can transfer her consciousness to the scout ship and eject that if she needs to.
Destruct sequence completed and engaged. Awaiting final code for destruct countdown.
Code 0, 0, 0. Destruct 0.
Destruct sequence is activated. This ship will self-destruct in...
Computer, override priority V0.
That code is not recognized.
You can use whatever dirty little programs you hid away to drag this ship halfway across the universe, but I command the computer. So I suggest you give up now, otherwise
Information. The intruder has tapped into the ship's power systems and channeled increased energy into the power conduits of wherever he is moving. The overflow of energy is leaking out and pulled to his circuitry, increasing his power tenfold.
Is he heading for the scout ship?
Negative. He appears to be heading for the bridge.
He's probably hoping to override the self-destruct. Nimue, is he capable?
Unknown at this time. The intruder was able to circumvent many security measures on this ship thanks to his knowledge of its internal workings.
Then we'll take the easy way out of this. Nimue, how long did you set the self-destruct for?
40 minutes will allow more than enough time for escape.
Kid, are you thinking what I'm thinking? Yeah, we're not gonna give him the chance to override. Nimue, lower the shields and heat up the Vigilant. With the shields down, full weapons on the engine room will blow this ship straight to hell.
Beginning scout ship start-up sequence.
Linkara to Linksano, we're abandoning ship. Get the cybermats and meet us in the hangar bay! Linksano?
Information. The intruder is drawing power away from several sectors, including internal communications, teleportation, and door controls.
Door controls! Oh.
Warning. There is not sufficient power within that weapon to cut through this door.
Nimue, can you get the door open?
Negative. A security sentry has been summoned to attempt to force it open, but with internal communications offline, there is no guarantee it shall arrive.
So what do we do now? The only thing I can do... review a comic book. Welcome to Atop the Fourth Wall, where bad comics burn. I think Star Trek III, The Search for Spock, is actually a really underrated film in the franchise. Not that I've ever run into anyone who thinks that it's a bad movie, just that it's an okay movie. Part of the problem is that it comes right after the powerhouse of awesome that was Star Trek II. I've gushed about that film so much already that I have nothing else to say other than you should go and see it and avoid the unnecessary comic adaptation made 27 years after the film came out. But back to Star Trek III. I actually think it's really good. As good as two? Of course not. But I think a lot of praise should go to Christopher Lloyd, who plays the Klingon villain Kruj. Many people consider him kind of a boring villain, not much going for him. However, I believe the problem of why he doesn't seem as memorable or interesting comes from the fact that he's not a particularly quotable villain. With Khan, you have an intense performance by Ricardo Montalban, where almost everything he says becomes an instant classic. The great thing about the character of Kruj, though, is in all the stuff you have to read into. It's more subtle in his character motivations and emotions. There's no way to talk about this without giving spoilers, but then again, why the hell would you be watching a video about a movie like this if you weren't ready for them anyway? We'll get into this as we proceed through the review, but Kruj is not evil, and he's not really motivated by selfish desires like Khan was. In Star Trek's latter years, Klingons started to become almost animalistic and cartoonish, to the point where you wondered how the hell a species like this ever developed space travel. But in these early days, when Klingons were still being fleshed out a bit, we have characters like Kruj, honorable and motivated by loyalty to his people and to his crew. Some exceptions notwithstanding, but I'll get to that later. Another problem with the film is that it doesn't exactly feel like a movie. If Star Trek Insurrection feels like a really crappy episode of a TV series, Star Trek III, The Search for Spock, feels like a really good episode of a TV series. And I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing, especially since there are plenty of episodes of any of the five live-action Star Trek series that I'd put above some of the movies. But that's why I say I get why a lot of people don't place Star Trek III that high on their lists of favorite movies. But I really like it, and we're going to look at its adaptation. This won't be like the reviews of the Star Trek II comics, primarily because this comic came out at the same time as the movie. The creative team probably only had a preliminary script to work off of, and maybe some cast photos to try to get the art to match them somewhat. However, unlike both the Motion Pictures comic adaptation and Star Trek II's adaptation, this comic is a 63-page one-shot. Admittedly, that's roughly the length of three issues, but still less than the total, so we'll see if that affects the pacing. So let's dig into Star Trek III: The Search for Spock. Yeah, I don't have a copy on hand. Like the motion picture adaptation, this one is available on that DVD of Star Trek movie comics. However, IDW, which currently holds the Star Trek comic license at the time of this video, has released a trade paperback collecting the comic adaptations of Star Trek 2, 3, and 4. So if you're interested in something in book form, there you go. Our cover is pretty good, and the art style actually looks like it could be a movie poster. Except it feels incomplete. I think the problem is that it's really lacking material in the upper right and lower left corners. There's just a bunch of blank space that you could fill with, I don't know, the Excelsior, David Marcus, I'm just throwing out ideas. As I've stated before, the Star Trek comic license has bounced around to a ton of publishers, and this time we're back to DC. Way back in 2009, you may recall my review of DC's Star Trek number 1, which was supposed to take place right after the events of Wrath of Khan. Well, it wouldn't be DC if they didn't wipe out their own continuity and start anew, as of course this comic completely invalidates their comic series they were publishing. We open on the Genesis planet, which in this shot looks like a magic 8-ball. We zoom in closer on the planet and come to Spock's torpedo, helpfully labeled in big, bright red letters, Mark IV. When Starfleet blows you up, they want you to know that it was with a quality Mark IV torpedo. Only cheapskates and Romulans use Mark I torpedoes. Hello, completely useless splash page trying to pretend this is a movie when it's, you know, an adaptation. We truly open on the USS Grissom, an Oberth-class starship. The Oberth class is the starship where you tilt your head and wonder, wait, how the hell does everybody get to the lower section of the ship unless they want to walk by the radiation from the warp nacelles? Captain Esteban has been sent to the planet along with David Marcus, but not Carol Marcus because we're never given a reason why not, and Savick, who apparently graduated from the Academy between movies, even though this takes place right after Star Trek II, oh, whatever. They've come to the Genesis planet to begin scientific analysis. They scan the planet and detect that certain patches within a few hours of each other are experiencing radical and rapid changes in weather, but they also detect a manufactured object. Based on the size of it, they reason out that the torpedo Spock was put into must have soft-landed on the planet by mistake. And of course, no one thinks, you know, maybe we ought to beam him back up. I mean, I know naval tradition and all that, but don't you think his family might want to give it a proper burial or something? They decide to inform Starfleet that they found the torpedo. And that leads to this panel of David giving Savick a shocked look. Why the hell is he looking at her like that?
Wait a second, you're not Kirstie Alley! Who are you?!
We cut over to the Enterprise shortly after they've rescued the crew of the Reliant from SETI Alpha 5. Captain's log, personal. With most of our battle damage repaired, we are almost home. And yet I feel uneasy, and I wonder why. Was the zombie Spock one of a kind, or merely a harbinger of the zombie apocalypse to come? Perhaps it is the erratic behavior of Dr. McCoy, or the emptiness of this vessel. Most of our trainee crew has been reassigned. Lieutenant Savick and my son David are exploring a new world, and the Enterprise feels like a house with all its children gone. And thank God for that, I can finally get some sleep around here, damn kids. It seems that I have left the noblest part of myself back there on that newborn planet. I feel almost as bad as that time when Spock's brain got stolen.
Stop laughing! That really happened!
The ship is heading into space dock for repairs, and Starfleet is being quiet anytime the Enterprise asks about Genesis. With most of the trainee crew gone, Scotty is working to automate a lot of the functions of the ship, which will be useful later. Kirk decides to head to his quarters, but runs into Dr. McCoy in the turbolift.
Are you planning to shave today?
Nah, I'm going back to the disco Unabomber look. I thought it gave me character.
McCoy asks Kirk where they're going, but when he says they're almost to Earth, McCoy says they're heading in the wrong direction.
Bones, don't do this. This is me, Jim, your friend.
And I have been, and always shall be, yours.
Damn it, Bones, don't quote Spock to me.
I get that enough at conventions. I don't need it from you, too. McCoy continues to be cryptic about wanting to go back to Genesis, sometimes saying to Kirk,
"Why did you leave me on Genesis?"
But he snaps out of it, and Kirk tells McCoy to accept Spock's death. We cut to a freighter in deep space.
Steady, boys. Keep scanning. If Mario goes into space once, chances are he'll do it again.
The captain of the freighter talks to a Klingon woman, Valkris, who... Wait, what the hell is she wearing? I don't mean just the weird-ass face mask that she has on for absolutely no reason. I mean the goofy headdress, too. Is that some ancient Klingon tradition?
It is very honorable to stick fried pickles on your head.
Anyway, the captain wants to know why their contact isn't there yet, and Valkris says they've been there for a while.
I can feel his presence.
Yeah, Klingons are very in tune with the Force, you know. Anyway, she sends out a general hail, letting them know that she has the data that he wanted. Kruge's ship decloaks, revealing the Klingon bird of prey. She transmits the data and says she thinks it'll be essential to his mission.
Then you have seen it?
I have, my lord.
That is unfortunate.
I understand.
And Kruge proceeds to blow up the freighter, killing his wife and proclaiming,
"You will be remembered with honor."
And here's that first point about Kruge's character and the first transformation of Klingons to what they would be in modern Trek. The emphasis on honor and, in this case, loyalty. Valkris doesn't plead, doesn't beg, but completely understands why she has to die. Given her attire, she's probably not a member of the Klingon military, and information about something like Genesis, a device capable of wiping out all life on a world, is probably not something that you can risk falling into anyone else's hands, so she can't be allowed to know about it. She understands completely, and Kruge does as well, so he grants her an honorable death, even though it probably pains him to do so. But that's small potatoes. Let's continue. Back at Genesis, the Grissom sensors detect an animal life form on the surface of the planet, even though there shouldn't be any life forms given that Genesis was only designed to produce plant life. Although, how the hell an ecosystem is supposed to flourish without animal life of some kind is rather head-scratching, but hey, future technology, alien worlds, whatever, I'll buy it. The captain, not being a total idiot, doesn't want to beam it up to the ship, so Savick and David suggest beaming down and taking a look at it themselves. Back over to the Enterprise, they enter space dock, and unlike the movie, we see that there are at least a dozen other ships sitting there, which is something I like. Otherwise, the movie reinforces my theory that only two starships are supposed to be active at any given time in Star Trek. but this will create a big-ass plot hole later. Anyway, particular care is given to show us the Excelsior, fresh off the construction lines and ready for trial runs. Scotty, however, is unimpressed.
I'm sorry, sir, but there's nothing needed for space travel that this old girl doesn't already have.
Come, come, Scotty. Young minds, fresh ideas. Be tolerant. After all, if you can be tolerant of this haircut, you can be tolerant of anything.
There's been a break-in in Spock's quarters, and Kirk decides to go check it out himself. When he goes in, he finds Dr. McCoy rambling and speaking as if he were Spock.
Climb the steps, Jim. The steps of Mount Celea. Or you can take the escalator. The escalator of Mount Celea.
McCoy passes out, and we cut to a few minutes later, where Kirk is meeting another admiral that's come on board with new orders. Shore leave for everybody except Scotty, who's being reassigned to the Excelsior.
But, sir, the Enterprise refit will need a practiced hand. It could take months.
Mr. Scott, there won't be a refit. The Enterprise is 20 years old. We think her day is over.
Ah, screw the historical significance of this ship. We're scrapping it the first chance we get. Kirk says he was hoping to take the ship back to Genesis, but the Admiral yells that it's out of the question, that it's considered a quarantined planet and a forbidden subject. Gee, it's almost like the Federation didn't consider a device capable of killing every living thing on a world would be controversial until right now! Anyway, we cut back to Cruz, who finishes watching the data he got, an updated Genesis briefing by Captain Kirk that talks about the Genesis planet. He asks for his men's opinion, and this is where I have to kind of grumble about a change in dialogue. As I stated before, Cruz is not a character motivated by selfish desires, but there's dialogue missing here that went to his character. When his men speak of the possibilities of Genesis, one of them says that it's impressive that they can create planets, to which Cruz replied,
"Oh yes, new cities, homes in the country, your woman at your side, children playing at your feet, and overhead, fluttering in the breeze, the flag of the Federation. Charming."
Clearly he's terrified that the Federation will use it as a weapon of war against the Klingons. Thus his motives aren't evil. Here, though,
"We are going to this planet, Maltz. We will act for the preservation of our race. With its secret, we will dominate. Destroy!"
Yes, the only way to preserve your race is to dominate and destroy! What? On Genesis, Savick and David find Spock's tube and discover a bunch of worms all over the surface of it. They theorize that they were microbes on the tube's surface that turned into these creatures. But how could they have evolved so quickly? And without a digivice to help out? Crazy! They open the tube and discover Spock's body is missing, but his burial robe is still there. Ah, great. Leonard Nimoy is high again. We're gonna find him naked and leaping from movie set to movie set, screaming the ballad of Bilbo Baggins. The planet suddenly shakes, much to the surprise of the two. Back to Kirk and company, he's holding a gathering of the Enterprise bridge crew, minus Scotty and Dr. McCoy, when Sarek, Spock's father, shows up. He demands to know why Kirk didn't bring Spock's body to Vulcan like he requested, but Kirk denies that any request like that was ever made. Sarek decides to mind-meld with him to get his thoughts on the matter. And thus he looks into Kirk's mind.
"There are literally hundreds and thousands of blinking, beeping, and flashing lights. Blinking and beeping and flashing. They're flashing and they're beeping. I can't stand it anymore! They're blinking and beeping and flashing!"
Finding nothing, Sarek apologizes, having assumed that Spock mind-melded with him before the end.
"Then his Katra, his living spirit, everything that he was that he knew, is lost."
Hey, don't feel sad. There's always reruns. Kirk suggests that he melded with someone else and cue up Star Trek II footage, realizing that it was McCoy who got the Katra. Sarek says that Kirk must travel to Genesis, get Spock's body, and bring both to Mount Celea on Vulcan.
Only there can both find peace.
Now, as my fellow reviewer SF Debris pointed out in his review of the film, this doesn't make a lot of sense. At this point, Kirk doesn't know that Spock's body is alive on Genesis. It isn't really a matter of a burial rites thing either, since Kirk isn't at all surprised later that Spock's body is walking around. And all the discussion after this suggests that it's about bringing Spock back to full charge and everything. Maybe my zombie Spock thing isn't all that off in this movie.
Kirk goes to the Admiral and requests that the Enterprise go to Genesis, but he refuses, since the Federation Council has ruled that no one but the science team go there. Kirk quickly departs.
The word, sir?
Bird is the word, Mr. Sulu. Kirk declares that he's going to go anyway, and of course Sulu and Chekov pledge to help. Dr. McCoy, meanwhile, heads to a space bar where he meets with an alien to try to charter a secret flight to Genesis himself. However, a Federation security agent is nearby who suggests that he shouldn't be talking so loudly about Genesis. What's amusing to me, but only because of hindsight, they probably didn't have a photo of the guy, is that in the comic, the security agent is a blonde-haired white guy, while in the movie, it's a black guy. Somehow this erupts into a bar fight, because it's fiction, you can't enter a bar without a fight breaking out, but it really leads to nothing except McCoy getting arrested after he tries and fails to do the Vulcan neck pinch on the security guy.
Oh, no, stupid. You got it much too high. It's down here where the shoulder meets the neck.
Savick and David find Spock, but the Genesis effect has somehow regressed him to a child. So it makes microbes bigger and more evolved, but it makes Spock smaller and younger? When they contact the Grissom about this, they're not sure how to handle it and decide to call Starfleet. However, the Klingons arrive and destroy the ship. Kruge is none too happy.
I told you! Disable their engine section only! I wanted prisoners!
A fortunate mistake, sir!
At this, he calls the gunner an animal and vaporizes him. Again, a note on his character. One might consider this a kill a subordinate for making a mistake cliche, but with the insult calling him an animal, I think it's again a demonstration of character. Kruge doesn't kill out of a desire to murder, but rather he'll kill for what he thinks are logical or honorable reasons. The gunner disregarded his orders just to destroy a science vessel and murder everyone on board. Let's face it, a science vessel is no match for a warship, and killing a weaker, practically defenseless enemy is pretty damn dishonorable. So he responded in kind by killing someone who couldn't obey orders and showed a blatant disregard for life and their mission. Yeah, maybe I'm wrong, but it's how I interpret his actions. Anyway, they detect life signs on the planet, and Savick reasons out that the Grissom has been destroyed and that whoever's responsible will be coming after them. We also have some scene reshuffling and condensing, which isn't as big a problem as it was in Star Trek II, though it is kind of odd that they're doing it so early. Savick asks about Genesis and notes that the planet isn't how David expected it to be. He admits that he used proto-matter in the creation of Genesis. Protomatter, an unstable substance which every ethical scientist in the galaxy has denounced as dangerously unpredictable. And considering how many times on this show we've seen just how evil science actually is, that's a pretty damning statement. It was the only way to solve certain problems, but my mother knew nothing about it. She only designed the killamatrix and the murderometer for the thing. Back at Starfleet, Kirk arrives to meet McCoy in a Federation holding cell. And promptly knocks out the guard with a judo chop. A little early there, Jimmy. He explains to McCoy about the mind meld and leads McCoy out. Sulu Haikiba's the other guard.
I told him not to call me Tiny.
When? They left that scene out of the comic. On board the Excelsior, Scotty has finished his own work and beams over to the Enterprise. Uhura's contribution to the escape is that she got herself stationed to an old transporter station on Earth, providing an escape for the group to the ship. She promises to rendezvous with them on Vulcan, because of course we can't have a girl along on the rescue mission, she'd ruin it with her cooties! Well, okay, they probably aren't going to need a communications officer on this mission, but I'm just saying an extra set of hands would probably be helpful, especially since you're not piloting the ship with a full crew. They begin their escape with the Enterprise, probably the best scene in the movie. Chekov reports that the Excelsior has orders to pursue them. Wait. What the hell? Kirk was wearing a leather jacket just a second ago! What, did he suddenly decide in between panels that it would be better if he was wearing his uniform? Especially on a mission where he's defying Starfleet and stealing a ship? In the next shot we see of him in it, it actually looks really badly drawn, like some comically oversized version of it with a huge Starfleet insignia too. Anyway, the Enterprise escapes and the Excelsior has been disabled thanks to Scotty.
Aye, sir. The more complicated the plumbing, the easier it is to stop up the drain.
I'm Montgomery Scott, and I endorse Drano for your pipes.
You know, we saw like 10 other ships in that space dock. Maybe you could have one of them quickly go after the Enterprise?
No? Okay. Over on Genesis, Kruge and his landing party are tracking David and Savick. Why they didn't just beam down to where they were, I'll never know. And we see that the microbe worms on the torpedo casing have evolved to rookie level and changed even further into fanged snake creatures. Because, of course, that's the direction evolution would take them in when they're in an environment without any predators or prey to speak of. When his officers are frightened of the snakes, Kruge takes a moment to pick one up and crush it to show he has no fear. In the movie, there's no real reason why the hell he does this, but I prefer to think from a storytelling perspective, it's to show he has great physical strength to complement his eventual battle with Kirk at the end. David reports to Savick that the planet is aging in surges along with Spock, and that because of the unstable protomatter, it's likely that the planet is going to explode within a few hours, days at best. Back on board the Enterprise, McCoy's uniform decides to shift between panels as well, going from his white coat to his full red uniform.
Great continuity!
Chekhov's uniform returns as well, though I'm less upset about that one. It fixes the absolutely hideous pink jumpsuit he was wearing in the movie. And back to Genesis. We do love not staying on one scene for too long. Spock has reached his teenage years and is undergoing Ponfar, the Vulcan biological need to mate every 7 years or they'll die. I say let him croak. He's already turned undead once. If he comes back again, we can officially count him as a Time Lord. But nah, Savick does the deed and the Enterprise arrives in the area. The Bird of Prey detects them first and cloaks. Back on the planet, Kruge's party has located the three and he demands to know the secrets of Genesis. They deny any knowledge, but before Kruge can interrogate them any further, his ship alerts him to the Enterprise's arrival. This is another great scene from the movie, as we see the experience of both captains being put to the test. Kruge hopes to catch his enemy by surprise, but they see the distortion caused by the cloaking device and ready themselves, arming weapons but keeping the shields down to lull them into a false sense of security. The ship decloaks and BAM! Kirk fires torpedoes on the Bird of Prey!
Sir, the cloaking device is destroyed! Bah, who cares about that? It's not like they're gonna use it in the next movie or anything!
The Enterprise, however, is in even worse shape. The automation system has been overloaded and they can't raise the shields. Kruge fires back and completely destroys the automation system, leaving the ship at the mercy of the Klingons. However, this is our next bit of insight into the coolness of Kruge. He's smart. Some of the lines are cut in the comic, but he recognizes that the Enterprise outguns their ship, and yet they're not finishing the job. And I just noticed that Scotty's wearing a uniform now, too. Was it really that damn important for all of them to change clothes after stealing the ship? Or in Kirk's case, during the theft? Kirk demands that the Klingons surrender, but Kruge calls his bluff and tells Kirk about his prisoners. To show that he means business, he orders his men to kill one of them. Savick is about to be stabbed in the back, but David intervenes and takes the knife for her.
Klingon bastard! You've killed my son!
Have I?
Okay, that line wasn't in the movie, but I do love how that doesn't even faze him 1 second.
I killed your son? Huh, neat.
Kruge demands their surrender, and Kirk agrees. They're given 2 minutes to prepare for their arrival, and Kirk starts plotting.
Mr. Sulu, what is the crew complement of a Bird of Prey?
About a dozen officers and men, sir.
Only a dozen? The ships are the same damn size! The crew complement of the Enterprise is about 400 people! Damn, those Klingons are efficient little buggers, aren't they? Anyway, Kirk orders Sulu and McCoy to the transporter room, while the remaining three activate the ship's self-destruct sequence. Kruge sends most of his crew over, hoping to take the superior ship and gain the Genesis information from the databanks. The bridge crew beam down to Genesis right before Kruge's men arrive, and the Klingons make their way to the bridge. When they arrive, they call Kruge and hear the self-destruct countdown, prompting their leader to yell at them to get out of there! And then Enterprise go boom! Ooh, crap. I don't think we're gonna get the down payment back on that.
My God, Bones. What have I done?
You forced us to change the opening narration. Now it's, these are the voyages of a bunch of guys who don't have a spaceship.
Fortunately, the crew is beamed down relatively close to Savick, Spock, and the Klingons holding them. On the Bird of Prey, Kruge has some lines that weren't in the movie.
He destroyed himself. One thing I didn't anticipate. A human has been bolder, more ruthless than I. That is the real dishonor.
Yeah, I don't like that, and I'll explain why in a minute. One of the Klingons, seeing Spock convulsing in pain, gets in closer for a look, ending up with Spock grabbing his face. Got your nose! Huh. I guess there is such a thing as the Vulcan death grip. Kirk arrives and kills the remaining Klingon, but then spots the dead body of David.
My son, to thee no star be dark, both heaven and earth, friend thee forever.
Jim, stop mourning your stupid dead son and check out your undead best friend!
Spock's not in good shape, since he's somehow linked to the planet, so they need to get him off of it as soon as possible, especially since the planet's breaking up. Kirk finds the Klingons' communicator and calls Kruge, telling him he has the secret of Genesis, but that he'll have to beam them up to get it. And here's where we need to stop and talk about Kruge again. My character analysis has been leading up to this moment. They cut it out of the comic, no doubt because it probably wasn't really specified in the script, but in the movie, this scene belongs to Christopher Lloyd. How do we see Kruge when Kirk calls him? With his head in his hands. And bear in mind that in the film, the last time we saw him, he was screaming his head off for his men to get out before the ship exploded. My interpretation of the character is that we see him recognize his own personal failure. He was confident he could salvage his mission, save his people, but he couldn't even save his own men. The men he ordered into a trap. It's his responsibility, his fault that his men died an honorless death. Not in battle, but what could be considered a cowardly act by his enemy. He's disgraced and dishonored himself. Thus, Kirk's call shows him his chance at redemption, not just for himself, but for the men he lost. And as such, he beams down himself to take on Kirk personally. And thus, when Kirk yells, "If we don't help each other, we'll die here!" his only response is, "Perfect! That's the way it shall be!" He has his last officer on board the Bird of Prey beam the rest up as prisoners, and we begin epic Kirk action scene! They fight until Kruge is hanging off a ledge, and Kirk, being a good guy, offers his hand, but Kruge just grabs his leg and pulls him down. Kirk kicks Kruge over the edge into, fire, since we don't see any lava in the comic version. So Kirk gets aboard, says he'll kill the Klingon later, then orders them to fly the hell out of there, Genesis exploding behind them. Kirk whispers a goodbye to David, tells the Klingon he was just kidding about killing him, and they make their way to Vulcan. And here's where we have that plot hole come up again about Spock's Katra. And not knowing about his body being alive. Kirk tells Savick to contact Vulcan and tells Sarek to prepare for the Katra ritual with Spock's body, but Savick explains that the Katra ritual is meant to deposit Spock's consciousness in the Hall of Ancient Thought, not in his body.
Then why the hell did McCoy and Sarek make such a big deal about leaving the body behind?
She does say that there is a ritual to restore Spock's Katra to his body, but it hasn't been done in centuries and is very dangerous. Anyway, the Bird of Prey soon arrives at Vulcan.
Open a channel to Ambassador Sarek. Tell him we're coming in.
This is Vulcan Space Traffic Control.
Oh my god, that's a Klingon Bird of Prey! Shoot it down!
They land the ship and take Spock's unconscious body out, carrying him up to Mount Seleia.
Live long and prosper, Spock.
And you are?
They reach the top and... Okay, really? Really? A giant Vulcan hand salute statue? How very logical of them. Anyway, blah blah blah, ceremony, it's dangerous. The rest of the crew waits farther down for a full day and apparently slept there too.
Strangest dream. I had the strangest dream that my son was dead and the ship that I loved had been destroyed. How did everybody else sleep?
Spock comes down the stairs to meet with them, but he's not exactly at 100% after this experience, not having a full memory of everything that happened. After talking with Kirk for a minute, he starts to remember his last moments of life, until finally,
Jim. Your name is Jim.
Yes! Welcome back, Spock!
And your name is Dr. McCoy.
That's right!
You owe me $10. So yes, Spock is alive again and regaining his memory.
Well, my work is done here.
What do you mean your work is done? You didn't do anything.
Didn't I?
And so our comic ends with a quote from Edith Keeler, a character from an excellent old Star Trek episode. You belong at your captain's side, Mr. Spock, as if you've always been there, and always will. Ready to have slash fics written about the two of you. This comic does not suck, but as an adaptation, that's trickier. It's not really a bad adaptation, and I always like seeing other bits of dialogue and scenes that weren't included in the movie itself. However, a lot of those scenes are also unnecessary, and unfortunately, it doesn't really fix any of the plot holes the film had. Plus, I'm disappointed at the handling of Kruge, who I still feel is an underrated villain in the movies, and I hope I've convinced some of you in the process. However, it's enjoyable, and the pacing moves along a bit faster than the movie, despite some artistic errors, and I'd say definitely worth a read. Hopefully, though, I can get out of here before my ship blows up.
Information. Internal communication is restored. The intruder is contacting you.
Put him on.
Disengage the auto-destruct sequence and relinquish this ship to me.
What, having some trouble there, Lordy Lou?
Quite the contrary. I believe I will have the auto-destruct disabled very soon, despite your extensive security measures. However, I am offering you a chance to leave now or suffer my wrath.
Thanks, but no thanks.
Do not think you can spar with me, champion. Others before you have tried and failed.
Yeah. Oh, and by the way, conqueror of universes, your reputation is a little exaggerated. Poyo was working on trying to free some of those other parallel universes. Turns out you would only conquer one or two worlds before you moved on.
The entity fled quickly whenever I closed in on it. The conquests ensured that I could more efficiently identify who or what it was possessing. A host body could more easily elude my sensors than its raw form. The reputation was just there to encourage compliance among future conquests. But it was not at all undeserved. I did not simply challenge champions. The entity was not the only multiversal threat I have encountered. It is simply the only one that survived battle with me.
And yet, I kicked your ass. Funny that.
I had grown complacent and was willing to believe Linksano since he showed no signs of infection by the entity. I thought him merely a genius with mad aspirations. I underestimated how devious he truly was. I will not make the same mistake again. Though I suppose I should thank him. He has shown me how I truly can only rely upon myself in this war with the entity.
I love how you're not even wearing that big-ass helmet anymore, and yet you're still as thick-headed. The entity is dead, Vyce!
I pursued the entity through universes of pure majesty. I chased it across cosmos and dimension, bore witness to entire worlds devoured in mere hours, and I found ways to pierce the skin of a being made of pure data. You are an ant who demanded the wind obey its commands. You could no sooner kill the entity than you could me.
There are visual records of it, you know.
At best, a ruse from the entity to buy itself time. At worst, a fabrication by you to deceive me. Either way is irrelevant. Surrender my ship so that I can continue my hunt.
Let you go on conquering worlds in the name of protection? That'll be the day. Linkara out!
Information. With internal communications restored, a security sentry was contacted and sent here to open the doors.
Ha! Imwe, you've earned your paycheck for this week. How much longer before the auto-destruct?
5 minutes.
More than enough time. Harvey, get down to engineering and help Linksano with whatever he needs to salvage. Then get to the Vigilant. What about you? Where are you going? To the bridge. I'm gonna try to stop Vyce from overriding the self-destruct. We cannot let him get possession of the ship again. If I don't make it back in time, use the emergency teleport on board the Vigilant to get me out of there. I'm on it, kid. Good luck.
Yo, Dr. Big Eyes! We gotta blow before the ship does!
I know, it's just...
Just what?
There was another teleportation signal right before ours. I've been trying to isolate it.
It doesn't matter right now, let's move!
Did you really believe that I would fall for the same maneuver twice? You are pathetic, champion. Even now, your efforts are futile.
Warning, self-destruct has been disabled.
You presume to exile me? Me? I am Lord Vyce, you impudent child! This is my ship! My reign shall continue as before! You are but a footnote in my glory! And when they build statues of me for my fight against the Entity, you will be the witless fool who tried in vain to... What?
Surprise.
Poyo! You transferred into the Tom Servo I had in the living room!
Yes, but the design is entirely different from my old one. It took me forever to figure out how to speak or move anything except my head, hoping you would notice it.
Well, I'm sorry I didn't. It's great to have you back, buddy. We'll get you into a new body soon enough.
Oh, and it looks like Vyce has fled.
What?
He's probably going to engineering.
I'm on it!
Wait, I'll go with you.
No! Poyo, stay here and secure the bridge! Vyce is not escaping this time! So why didn't we blow him out of the sky while he was right there?
Normally I'd be happy to, but whatever he did to override the self-destruct screwed up the external sensors. We couldn't get a fix on him, and we're still repairing them.
The good news is that the ship's deflector system keeps him from coming anywhere near us, and he was pushed away from the ship.
Can't he just fly back to Earth?
I sincerely doubt that. From what we can tell, that body was heavily damaged in the hover skirt malfunctioning. And even if he did manage to repair it, we were on the edge of the solar system. It would take him decades on the limited propulsion of that body to get back here. And that body didn't even have enough internal power to get halfway here, much less resist the gravitational pull of planets.
We should still try to find him and finish the job, but in the meantime, we have other issues to address. When this all started, I promised you a new body, and damn it, you're gonna get one.
I am thinking this one should have better radiation shielding.
Consider it done.
And be bigger.
We'll talk about it.
And arms that actually work.
Have you ever tried to build arms? It's not easy.
I'm sorry, all I did was save your life. Again.
And just what can I do to appease you in the meantime?
And that is why Red Hood and the Outlaw sucks.
Poyo, my cutoff date is 1 year after release. Could you really not wait until September for me to review this?
Stop interrupting my review, robot.
Just because you're wearing my outfit does not make me the robot.
You're absolutely right. Hey, what is this? I seem to have accessed your bank account remotely. What lovely money you have.
Beep, beep. I am a robot.
And yet, your arms work.
I'm so glad he's back.
What's that?
Lexarin.
Lexarin? What for?
You're suffering from a Vulcan mind meld, Doctor.
That green-blooded son of a bitch. It's his revenge for all those arguments he lost.
I will return. I will return.